Today we're dancing in the streets with Martha Reeves.
On the Les Brown Show.
And we're exposing Exposé's latest hit.
When the rain's pouring down.
Girl groups then and now, today on the Les Brown Show. Over the years, millions of girls dreamed of being a chiffon, or Shangri-La, or Bangle, or a go-go. What was it really like for a young woman to be part of an all-girls singing group or world-famous rock band? And what do you do when the music ends and the party's over? We have an all-star show today that will enlighten you and entertain you, beginning with our legendary first guest. 3 decades ago, along with her backup group, the Vandellas, this magnificent lady topped the charts with one of the great pop singles of all time. You can hear that song again on this new Motown collection entitled Live Wire, or you can enjoy it with us here today. Please welcome Martha Reeves.
Across the nation, a chance for folks to meet. How y'all feeling? Laughing, singing, music swinging, we're dancing in the street. Philadelphia, PA, Baltimore, and DC now. Can't forget the Motor City, Detroit.
Fabulous. Well, don't you look
great? Telling me that.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Where is home for you?
Detroit. Okay. But I was born in Eufaula, Alabama.
Uh-huh. Yeah, now, when you went to Motown working, what capacity were you in when you first started there?
Well, I did go there to work. I went there for an audition, but I came on the wrong day.
Okay.
I was asked to answer a telephone and became the first A&R secretary for Motown Records.
And then one fateful day, what happened?
Well, one day I happened to have been in the studio when the union came in and was asked to do my vocals on a demonstration record for Mary Wells, who wasn't there at the time. And It became my first record. Barry liked my voice on it, and I called the Delphi's in, who became the Vandellas, with a little bit of strings being pulled here and there, and we became.
And what was your first national hit?
The first one didn't sell. I'll have to let him go, only sold about 4 copies, and I still have mine. And Come and Get These Memories charted for us. It was top 20.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Come and Get the,
Come a lot and of Get These Memories, your teddy bear, friendship ring, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm. So now, you've been traveling, you're still singing?
35 years straight.
Isn't that beautiful? What would you say that was the most unusual thing ever happened to you as a performer on stage? Many times you have mistakes and things that go on. What's one of the most unusual things that comes out in your mind?
Where can I start? Rosalind of the original Vandellas. Rosalind and I were performing at the Howard Theater, and her dress came completely unzipped all the way down.
Oh,
So as part of the routine, I danced behind her, and I zipped it back up, and no one noticed but us.
Oh, yeah. Who's your favorite thing around today? Any of the performers that you like very much?
So much good music being made today, I can't say it's special. My favorite thing is listening to music and watching other people perform.
Now, did you start out in the church? Many singers do.
My grandfather was a Methodist minister, of course. Mm. I went to church 4 days a week.
Oh, boy. So I'm sure that we've heard a lot of that in your singing over the years.
Oh, by all means.
Yeah, you ever go back and sing in church?
Oh, every chance I get.
Come
I was
down
at
here,
Mount
please,
Zion Lord. Missionary Baptist Sunday, and I sang then. Uh-huh. Just past Sunday.
I have a question. What did you think of David Bowie's and Mick Jagger's version of Dancing in the Street?
I loved them for it. We met the Rolling Stones in 1962 over in England. We did a Ready, Steady, Go show that's being sold now in video shops. And it was like a letter from them saying, "Hi, we still remember you." And they shared a lot of their fans with us.
Mm-hmm. When you think about the entertainment industry now, how has it changed then compared to where it is now?
People used to love more. We still have a lot of avid fans and friends who have remained with us over the years. In fact, there are a few here in the audience today that I met in 1962 that are still with me and still supporting us and still keep us going, inspiring us.
Mm. When you think about the performers in terms of versatility, I saw a group that I had not seen for many years, and they were playing and singing, as well as having a great deal of showmanship. The Commodores, I mean, they were just phenomenal to me. Do you see that performers today have that same kind of versatility?
Well, they were not unique, because the first instrumental band on Motown Records was Junior Walker and the All-Stars.
When we come back, the Les Brown Show will reign supreme with a young lady that I'm sure you're going to recognize and remember right after these words. Welcome back. We're talking about girl groups then and girl groups now. In 1960, 3 high school girls from Detroit joined Motown Records and embarked on a career that would capture the attention of a worldwide audience. The Supremes became the girl group of girl groups, delivering 12 number one hits on the pop charts. But the breakup of the Supremes did not slam the brakes on our next guest. Today, she continues living her dream as a talented singer and performer. Please welcome Mary Wilson. We'd like to welcome you. Now, you know, as fast as you got your high school diploma, you had a record contract. Big hits going. What was that like for teenagers?
First of all, it definitely was overwhelming, but it wasn't as overwhelming as I think it would have been had we not been singing years before that. Because we're right now, the Supremes are celebrating their 30th anniversary in show business, but that's when the hit started in 1964. There were years before that, 1959, we actually started singing in elementary school. So by the time we got to high school and got the hit record, we were well seasoned and very ready for our career. We had at Motown Records people like Charlie Atkins, who taught us the choreography. We had Maurice King, who taught us the harmonies. We went out on the Motown Reviews with Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, Mary Wells. Martha. Uh-huh. And so by the time we actually became stars, we really were well prepared. And more than all the other things, we were prepared mentally. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what kept us from being overwhelmed, because we knew the pitfalls. We knew what it was like to change in small areas, mm-hmm. or to be thrown together with all kind of people. So we were very well prepared.
Let's take some questions from our audience here.
I had the golden opportunity of growing up with these ladies, and I can remember going to the Apollo and watching their shows. It was always an intimate setting at the Apollo. It was always almost as if I could reach out and touch you. I'd like to know, what's the difference for you in entertaining at a larger stadium or something opposed to entertaining at the Apollo?
Well, first of all, the Apollo is the place that everyone would love to have performed at. If you made it at the Apollo, you could make it anywhere, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, I recall when we did a Motown Review once back in 1962, well, it was before then, when we were really, that was our first time there, and we were scared to death. Flo, Diane, and myself were so scared, because we, unlike Martha, were not as soulful as the Vandellas, right? So we went up there, and we were like so scared. We're standing up there, we're like, well, are they gonna like us? Are they gonna like us? We go out there, and we start singing our song, and they just went wild and accepted us, and once we were accepted there, we said, hey, we can do it anywhere. But to answer your question, as opposed to the intimate and the large, I think when you're a performer, as long as you have people out there, if you have one or two, it really doesn't matter, because if you are a true performer, you will give your all, because that's what you love doing. And so it's, to me, it doesn't matter.
Just so everybody's
there. Now, more money with the large audiences.
All right. I would like to know, why did the Supremes break up?
Why did did you read my two books?
No.
I said maybe my sisters read your book, because I, growing up, they bought all your records with Diana Ross and stuff like that.
The only reason why I said it, because it is a very long story. But basically, Florence left in 1967. Florence left in 1970. Diane left in 1970, and I entered the group in 1977, mainly because after Diane left, we got very little support from the business, the record company, and it was just time to call it quits.
Yeah. Martha, the Vandellas still around? Are they still performing?
I perform with the original Vandellas on every occasion. They have 9-to-5 jobs with Rosalind Holmes, and Annette Helton and I have traveled to Europe for the last 5 years as the original group, mm-hmm. and this is our reunion. I do use my sisters, Lois and Delphine, who are my second string. So when you don't see Rosalind and Annette, you see my sisters, Lois and Delphine.
Okay.
I have a question for Mary, but first I want to say, Martha, in 1968, I saw you at the Copa for my high school prom. And you're as beautiful now as you were then, and you sound just as good.
All right.
What I'd like to ask Mary is, what advice you would have for somebody coming up today that wants to get into the singing business, as opposed to... A lot of the record companies back then, when you all were starting out, ripping off and taking advantage of young singers like yourselves?
Well, I personally think that it's very important for any young person going into any business, and especially applies to the music industry, to get as much education as they can. This is a key thing, because you have a lot of agents, various managers and people who take care of your money, and you're not able to really tell them what to do unless you know this. So I really stress education. That's
in
number
every walk
one
of life, not in just every singing and performing, but being
as
formed
well.
Everyone.
And I like to also add to that, and that is the point of, if you're going into a career, don't go into it because you want to make money or be a star. Go into whatever you want to go into because you like it, you enjoy it, because this is your job for the rest of your life, and you really should enjoy doing what you're doing, because you do a much better job, it makes people around you much happier, and you're much happier. We have a lot of suicide from people in the industry because they're really not happy with themselves. They become these huge stars, but then inside they're still this little person. So you've got to feel good about yourself. You only can only feel good about yourself if you're liking what you do.
You know, so Mary, I want to ask you about how you stay grounded and rooted in that kind of profession. Right after you take time out for these words, we'll be back with more with Mary Wilson and Martha Reeves. talking about girl groups then and girl groups now, and we're with the lovely Mary Wilson and Martha Reeves.
Yes, my question is for Mary. What was it like working with Diana Ross, and what is she really like as a person? Because I heard some, you know,
different things,
and I want to know from you, from your mouth.
When we first started singing, the most beautiful moment of my life was when I met Diane and Florence. And we had, unlike what some people may have thought from my books, we had a wonderful relationship. She was a great friend. I mean, we would lay on the bed and make dresses together. We'd flirt with the guys together. We were really tremendous friends. And she is a really lovely person. Yes. Okay.
Hi. Sexual harassment is like a topic of the 90s, but it's hard to imagine it didn't exist in the 60s.
We didn't harass too many guys.
Was it a problem, and what did you do?
We had chaperones, and they took care of that.
Was it difficult for you as females and African Americans during that time breaking into the music industry?
Well, yes, it was.
What were some of the special problems you had to overcome?
Well, first of all, remember we did a tour in the South.
He's in the restroom sometimes.
Right. We did a tour in the South, and it was very difficult for us to actually use public areas in a lot of different places. In fact, one time we were on the tour with Mary Wells and some other people, and after the show, everyone accepted us very well, but there were gunshots at the bus, and we actually had to get out of town really fast.
Oh, I want to comment. You both look fabulous.
Thank you.
And I want to know, do you see any of the old groups like the Dells, Smokey Robinson?
Oh, yes. The Dells, Stimps. We're still very good friends. In fact, a lot of people ask us about the Motown family. And that is really very, very true. We, the artists, were always very, very close. Mm-hmm. And it definitely was a Motown family. And today, I keep in touch with Melvin Franklin. We write each other all the time. We're all pretty close.
Yes. Martha, do you remember the most memorable moment you've had in entertainment, meeting a lot of people? You know, you guys have met people like the Beatles and all of the great giants in the industry. You remember Jackie Wilson, Sam Cooke? Who are some of these people that stand out in your mind, some special moments?
I saw Sam Cooke about a month before he was killed. Mm-hmm. And I thought he was one of the most gorgeous men I've ever seen with my eyes. Mm-hmm. But as children, my brothers and I used to imitate the Soul Stirrers. That's where mm-hmm. we got our basic harmonies from the Soul Stirrers and gospel singers like that.
Where'd you get the name Vandella?
Well, Della Reese is my favorite artist, one of my favorite artists, and as a child I saw her at the Friendship Baptist Church, and she was singing Amazing Grace, and then the next day I saw her on television, and she was singing one of her hit records. So when we had 15 minutes to choose a name, because Berry Gordy was in a hurry to press the record, I've chose Della from Della Reese. I lived near Van Dyke as a child, and my family still lives there. Van Dyke is a street that runs all the way through parallel through Detroit, and if you're from Detroit, you know where Van Dyke is. And I wanted to have a name that would remind a lot of people of Detroit. So Vandella was derived from Delphi's Della Reese, my sister Delphine.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd like to know who your biggest influences were.
Pardon?
Well, you're Mary Wilson
influence.
Because Della Reese was Martha's biggest
influence. No, not necessarily now.
Uh-oh. Well, speak for yourself.
Yes, yeah. No, I had the occasion to listen to a lot of female vocalists thanks to my brother, Benny, who was in the military and in the Columbia Record Club. And Mahalia Jackson, Yuma Sumac, Morgana King, Sarah Vaughan, Ella Fitzgerald, all of them have influenced me in my career.
What about you, Mary?
Well, I tell you, for me, the Shirelles were one of my favorite all-time groups. I mean, in fact, as a climax, you know, the Shirelles were it. There was Laverne Baker, Jim Dandy to the rescue.
What about Ruth Brown? How about Ruth Brown?
I actually grew up listening to a lot of jazz as well.
Okay, very good. When we come back, where did the Go-Go's go and why did the Bangles go bust? Right after these words. Welcome back. In the late 70s, the term girl groups took on a whole new definition. All-female rock groups who not only sang but also wrote their music and played instruments. Then the first were the Go-Go's, who along with their hit, We Got the Beat, became the biggest-selling female rock band of all time. And joining us is a former Go-Go, now a solo artist, whose new CD, The Very Best of Jane Wheatland, is hot off the presses. Welcome, Jane Wheatland. And alongside Jane is a former singer and guitarist of the group who taught us how to walk like an Egyptian. They were the Bangles, and after they left the music scene, Manic Mondays just weren't the same anymore. Currently with another rock band, Continental Drifter, please welcome Vicki Peterson. Jane, how did your group form?
Well, in 1977, I got involved with the LA punk scene. Yeah. And at that time, there was about 50 of us, 50 punks.
Okay.
And all the guys already had formed their own little bands, and the only people left were the girls. So, you know, a couple of us girls got together and said, gee, let's start a band. Mm-hmm. And we just did it for fun, and it was the first band I'd ever been in. And all of a sudden, the audiences started liking us, and, you know, 3 years later, we got a record deal.
Was it difficult getting that record deal?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No one wanted to sign us. All the major labels thought that there was no way that an all-female band could sell records. I mean, it was like being able to play an instrument and writing your own songs was a curse. Mm-hmm. You know, you'd think they would have thought that was something cool, but at that time it was like, oh no, it's never been done, can't be done. So finally, the only company that wanted to sign us was a really small label called IRS. And they took a chance on us because the president thought it was a good novelty.
How did you handle the fame at that young age?
Well, in, I guess, 81 or 82, our first album went to number one, and it was hard. I don't think we handled it very well.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Vicki? How did you handle it at your young age?
Actually, I think with the Bangles, it was a bit more of a casual progression from being garage band to a band with a major label deal to a band with a hit record. We didn't, our first album didn't do what the Go-Go's first record did. You know, we built a bit of a base following, and we got, you know, we didn't have a big smash hit single on the first record. So we just worked hard. We were just working hard. So it wasn't until we were pretty well embroiled in the whole thing before we had a big hit single. So, mm-hmm.
You know, we were talking earlier with Mary and Martha. You mentioned about many entertainers have committed suicide and just self-destruct because they could not handle the fame. How do you stay grounded and rooted when you have that kind of notoriety worldwide?
I think the first thing is that you really have to know yourself as an individual, and you have to like yourself as an individual, and you have to believe in something. You know, I've always believed in God, and my second book was called Supreme Faith, and I think that's really important for anyone in any business. You gotta know yourself and like yourself, and then you gotta surround yourself with the right people. You know, that's another thing.
Yeah. Now, Martha, you went through some very challenging times, one period in your career when things were not working out for you. How did you pull yourself out of it?
Well, to answer your first question, my mother kept me rooted. Whenever she saw me, she'd always call me back down to earth and let me remember who I am and what I do. Mm-hmm. And I was reborn in 77 after a lot of tragic things happened to me, and I've been grounded by faith, and I'm a firm believer that Jesus Christ is the author and the finisher of my faith. Mm-hmm.
What would you say is the most difficult part of being an entertainer, Jane?
When you're successful, you're surrounded by people that always say yes all the time. I mean,
well, it seemed like everybody would want that.
Yeah, it's not good for you, though. It's not good for the soul. You don't grow. Yes. I think the times that I experienced personal growth were the times where I wasn't a success, wasn't doing well. Mm-hmm. And even though you hate to go through that stuff, I don't think you're going to turn into a grown-up or a good human being without it.
Mm-hmm. Hi, I'd like to know how much of a role do each of you think sexuality played in your success as artists?
What do you mean by that?
Do you think, you know, not to deny anybody's talent here, because I think you're all wonderful, but do you think sexuality was something that led to the mass success that each of you had, and was there any difference in that between the 60s and the 80s?
I'm still confused on what you mean by sexuality in that.
Right.
All right, playing a role in your success. Let me say,
well, maybe I should change that to sensuality. Okay, and the attractiveness
maybe
to you.
I see, you mean about being attractive.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Sensuality has a lot to do with it. However, the music, I think, is what touched the hearts and souls of our listeners and our fans.
Because your sensuality won't show up on a record.
No, it won't. Yeah. I think the heartfelt efforts is what shows up on the records, and people love you for that.
Yeah.
There's always been, I mean, rock and roll is about sex. You know, you can't deny it. The all-boy bands use it all the time. Mm-hmm. It just depends on how you want to present yourself. And I think you have to know yourself, and you have to be comfortable with yourself. But, you know, there were things that went on in the Bangles that I personally wasn't comfortable with because that wasn't me, you know. And I didn't like being presented in an overtly sexual way because I didn't think that represented what I was about and what the band was about, really.
Mm-hmm. And there's often a lot of pressure from within the industry to be more sexual, to push that. I think a lot of,
it's a cheap
you
sell.
Know, old-fashioned, you know? Old-thinking male, hate to say it, record executives think, oh, it's easy, we'll push more product if she'll just take more clothes off.
Chicks in short skirts.
Yeah. Let's take some questions here from our audience.
Ladies, you really look marvelous.
Thank you.
What do you do to stay in shape?
I'm watching you. I'm looking at you.
I don't watch what you eat.
What do you say?
I'm just watching them.
No, you work real hard and watch what you eat. You do have to watch what you eat. You can't just have the ice
cream.
We're
vegetarians.
That you want.
Yeah, but Martha, we had ice cream last night.
I know, but I have yogurt.
I'll say this about one thing. You should watch what you eat. A lot of times it's not always good when you're on the road. I mean, when we're traveling, you cannot get good food. Yeah. But you do have to not gorge out on horrible things. I work out a lot. I'm not a fanatic at it. But I think about how I look because to me it's important. Not the sensuality part of it, you know, because I agree with what you were saying. A lot of times you have record producers who will try to, you know, tell you to do certain things. And that's a sort of like a male kind of way of looking at it. But as I said, it's up to the females to know what they're all about and not go out there and fall for it.
Well, whatever you're doing, just keep it on going, all right?
Yeah. I do want to say one more thing. Can I say one more thing?
Yes.
Just one more thing. I do want to say, at Motown, we really did not have that problem. They were really about the music, and I think Martha and I...
We had chaperones that stopped us from being too sexual.
They did not try to sell us. Yeah. I mean, they didn't try to sell us, you know, for the sex. Right. It was like,
we
really...
We sold talent. We didn't
sell
sex.
Well, when
sex.
We come back, we're going to have a performance by one of the hottest groups in America today. I mean, a real hot female group, right after these words. This is Mrs. Mamie Brown's baby boy. Does your mom deserve to be Mother of the Year? Call me at 1-800-291-2535 and tell me why. You both could be on my show. We've been talking about female vocal groups and rock groups of the 60s and 70s and 80s, and now in the 90s, a whole new wave of female groups are taking command of the record store shelves and making their presence known. Groups like SWV, En Vogue, Jade, and TLC keep busting the charts, and we are fortunate to have one of today's hottest groups with us. Three beautiful young ladies who have delivered more top 10 single hits than any female group since the Supremes. Performing their newest release from their latest album is Exposé.
It always comes through. There's not a soul that's lost. They can't find its way. There's not a night that's long that can't find this way. There's not a night that's long that can't find the day. As long as I can dream, there's a better way. Oh, there's a better way. I see it shining. In my dreams I see there's a better world. Oh, there's a better world.
Expose will tell us what it's like being a girl group in the 90s right after these words. Welcome back to the Les Brown Show. As girl groups then meet girl groups now, and we have just heard from the beautiful sounds of Jeanette, Ann, and Kelly, better known as Expose. We have some questions from our audience.
I just wanted to ask and tell Expose that I think you're all beautiful, and I love your voices, and I was just wondering, When
you forgot what you were wondering? She said, tell her what she was wondering. Okay. Yes, excuse me just a minute. Let me get your little friend that you're calling on over here. Okay, what is the question that you have?
To Expose, did you take singing lessons when you were children?
Actually, no, I didn't. But I did take singing lessons when I was 17. I began taking singing lessons.
I think it's the same for all of us.
Yeah. Around the same age.
How did you get together as a group?
Let's see. I met Anne in Florida over dinner at a Mexican restaurant. And Kelly, I met, we have this thing with food, at Jerry's Deli in Los Angeles. Yeah. Yeah. And just as easy as that.
Yeah. And 2 years ago, your group had a major decision to make when you had to replace a member.
Right.
Tell us about that. How did you handle that?
Well, the person who used to be in the group, Joya, had formed nodes on her vocal cord on our last tour. And so she took some time off and she wasn't able to come back. And at that time, Annie and I were deciding or trying to make the decision as to whether to add another person or whether it was going to be just us two. And we actually went into the studio.
Right. We were actually started recording and weighing the decision about what to do. And
and decided that we wanted to continue on as three females, and that's when we found Kelly.
Yeah, there was a sound missing there, and that we really needed
to... The third part.
Well,
groups have had to do that over the years.
Yeah.
There's a subject... I'm wondering whether or not the public is always accepting of a new member.
We're kind of... worried whether they would or not. Mm-hmm. But I think a lot of it has to do with the relationship that we have between us, because once they see that we've accepted her, that we get along, and the new sound, if they like that, I think it's easier for them to accept it.
You look at many groups that were together that broke up. What do you put into your personal relationships to keep your success rolling?
Constant communication. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You think that's important?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yes. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And lots of laughter.
Uh-huh.
And sense of humor, absolutely.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
I wanted to ask Mary and Martha, of the performers of today, what are some of your favorites?
Luther Vandross, Brenda Russell.
Yeah. There's a new guy from Detroit by the name of Keith Washington.
Yeah.
And the Winans.
Oh. Yeah. Yeah.
My question is, of course, I'd like to give all the ladies a compliment. All of you have beautiful voices. And the exposés. Anne, as I noticed, she has a tremendous range on her voice. And my first question, I have two questions. My first question is, what is your range? I mean, how many octaves can you go up? I mean, how does that...
I haven't the slightest idea.
So get to your second question quickly. What's the second one?
I would like to have you sing for me privately.
Wait, I want to be her manager now. We want big money for that.
Yeah,
I'm going to have to charge you.
I can't believe he held his hand up all that time for that question. I can't believe that. I want to know, when you're traveling on the road, what do you find most difficult about being stars and traveling right now?
I'm sorry, but we've been laughing about this whole thing. We went on kind of like a promotional tour, and towards the end of the tour, it was our very last show, and we sat around and looked at each other and started laughing because I think each of us had put on about 6 pounds.
We looked at each other, and Kelly came up to me and she said, "Oh, I think I've gotten really fat over here. Look at this." And I sort of punched it a little bit. I said, "Yeah, you are fat.
You're right." So I think it's staying healthy. It's really hard to find time to work out, and I think one of you mentioned it's really difficult to find the right food.
Especially vegetarians.
Especially vegetarians.
Yes.
She's a vegetarian.
Right. Yeah, I have a really hard time.
All right, let me take another question here.
Okay, my question's for Exposé. All of you are like really young, and as far as your future in singing goes and starting a family, how do you plan to juggle both of them?
I have no idea. We're getting, I guess, in that age and in our career when we do start thinking about children, and I'd love to have kids. I just don't know when. I mean, or how.
I tell you what, we're going to give you time to think about that during the break.
Okay.
Right after these words. If you're going to be in the New York area and would like free tickets to the Les Brown Show, please call us at 212-650-2060. Welcome back. We're talking about girl groups then and girl groups now. Yes.
Question.
Yeah. You got a question.
Actually, it's for all of you that are here. Does it ever bother you, the fact that everyone calls you a girl group rather than female?
Yeah, the all-woman group doesn't work, I guess, as well.
No, it doesn't.
Female groups.
Female
because they
groups.
Say male
all
groups.
Girls
groups
sounds kind
all...
of strange to me because none of us are
yes.
girls anymore.
Okay.
We're
female
women.
Groups and female
yeah.
groups. Yeah.
You got me.
All right.
But I had to take
as old as I am. When you get to be 50, you'll be glad to be called a girl.
Because so many people say it, you know.
Yes, all right, well,
so I throw that out.
Let me ask you this then. As a female group, Vicky, you know, when you look back on your career in the music industry, what sound advice would you give to Exposé?
There's a lot of things, but I'm going to keep it short. Just stick with the people who really know you and knew you before you guys have had any success, and trust them. Trust your instincts. You know, when people are trying to tell you to do something, trust your instincts because you're probably right. You know what's right for you. you know, save your money.
Yeah.
I think that we're very fortunate too. We have a great support system. We are great friends, the three of us. Mm. We also have great families and close-knit friends.
That's great. That'll help a lot.
Yeah. It really does.
Yeah, Jane, what would you say?
I think the main thing is to remember that success is fleeting and to try really hard to enjoy it when it's there, because there's a tendency to get so busy and swamped and stressed out that you're number one, but you're freaking out. You're not going, God, I'm number one. You're going, oh, my God, another interview. You know, so really enjoy it while it lasts.
Very true. Thank you.
And also, I think to keep your own identity too. I mean, it's good. It's great to be in a band and have the support of your band members, but it's really important to be your own person, because eventually you're going to be yourself again and not just one of Exposé.
That's a really good point, though, because probably with all of us, we understand that. I don't think it makes a group unless each is able to show her own individuality.
Right.
Because this group is so much about us, you know, being individuals, and we're very strong-minded women, and we allow everyone to know that. It doesn't make everyone else happy, but it makes us happy.
Yeah, Vicki, how did you keep your identity after your group dissolved?
That was real easy for me, because I had a couple personal situations happen. My fiance was diagnosed with leukemia, and I went out of music business altogether for a full year, and had a real life experience. And
what about you, Jane? Yeah, you said it, so that kept you grounded.
It completely flipped things around for me. So now I just do what I like. I sing with Susan Cowsill and the Psycho Sisters. I sing with the Continental Drifters. I do everything that I want to do right now that makes me happy. You know,
just,
I feel good.
Jane, what about you? How did you keep your sense of identity intact?
I left the Go-Go's before they disbanded, because there were so many problems within the band, it became obvious that it wasn't working. But
I respected you for that.
Thank you. It was hard to leave a success like that. But I found that I turned to what was important to me before the band started, because once I got in that band, it just consumed me. And I remembered things like my high school friends. I found them again, and those are my friends now, or the people I grew up with. And my interests as a child, animals and horses and the country, are all the things I grew up with, and I went back to that. And I think that your childhood is what you are. And, you know, once you get out of a band, it's... I guess to me, that's what made me remember who I was.
Listen, thank you. We'll be back with more after this. Had a fabulous time with females from the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and now the 90s, and they're all still going strong. What you've shared together has been fabulous. We thank you for it. This is Mrs. Mamie Brown's baby boy, Leslie Calvin Brown, saying, I see you next time.